I'm Anders Hegstrom with the Daily Caller, and with me today is Dr. Shiloh Valentine. She's a cardiovascular specialist. She's a board member, an advisory board member of Women for Trump. Thanks so much for coming on. We appreciate it.
Thank you. It's a privilege to be here.
Mm-hmm. All right. So we have heard, obviously, from the vice president from the Trump administration, the coronavirus task force, that we can expect a sort of abatement of the coronavirus coming this summer. But Americans are obviously happy to hear that kind of thing. But what does it actually mean for, like, what activities will they be able to expect to be doing this summer that they can't be right now?
Well, let's look at history. If the virus follows the path of the Spanish flu, we may see a second wave in the fall, which actually may be more severe, and then a third wave early 21. There's another scenario that we'll see little wavelets early next year, or we may see a slow burn of transmission. But I think to your question, this summer, people are going to reenter their lives. Our doors have got to open for our lives. And I think what we're seeing is that people are going to be smart and cautious and recognize that this virus is going to be here, and we just need to continue to work hard to prevent it.
Mm-hmm. And so let's talk a little bit more about that fall resurgence and the potential 2021 resurgence that you mentioned. What are the factors that go into that, and what can America do right now to prepare? Because obviously a vaccine is pretty far down the road. It's certainly not going to be out by this fall, at least assumedly. So what sort of measures should the Trump administration be taking, should state governments be taking to mitigate that?
Well, as you know, there's 100 researchers that are in hot pursuit of a vaccine, and optimistically, we could have it by the end of the year, but most likely it'll be next year. I think that personal responsibility is the most important thing. I mean, our president has executed a bold and comprehensive attack. In concert with that, though, going forward, we have got to continue personal responsibility. Because if you look at the virus as a baseball game, we're in the second inning. And so we cannot take our foot off the pedal. We have to continue to be aggressive to prevent this disease from either affecting us or our families, or certainly not to pass it on to the vulnerable population.
Mm-hmm. And what does this mean, do you think, for obviously the presidential election, the general election is coming up in the fall? There have been talks of mail-in ballots, changing this election structure. Do you think that's a good idea? Do you think that's necessary? Or is that a decision we should make at a later date?
One word, no. We've got an election in 179 days, and there's no reason to enter into any sweeping changes. President Lincoln was reelected in the throes of the Civil War during the Spanish flu. It was an off-year election, but it was held. And I don't think voters have an appetite for change. I don't think they have an appetite for a sudden change in mail ballots. I will tell you from a personal note, my husband is a political strategist, and he exposed significant voter fraud recently, and most of the fraud involved mail ballots. And so I think that the American voters want to go to the polls and vote. Now, with respect to the virus, I mean, we go to the grocery store, our carts are wiped down, we've got arrows in the lanes and distance markers in the checkout stand. So there's no reason to believe that we can't execute those same things at the ballot box. So I look forward to it.
Mm-hmm. And so we've heard a lot of protesting in particular states like Michigan, regarding the social distancing, the lockdown guidelines, essentially. A lot of Americans are saying that they want churches to be deemed an essential business, essentially. Do you think that's a good idea? Is this a legitimate gripe, is what I'm saying? Because a lot of Americans are saying their First Amendment rights are being infringed upon, and yet there is this interest in curbing the spread of the virus. So where would you say the balance goes there?
Researchers have looked at the most critical things that have prevented the spread of this virus. And it has been cultural things, social distancing, the lack of exposure to the vulnerable, and the government's response, the timing of response. So without question, from a scientist's perspective, social distancing has made a huge difference and has saved lives.
And as a member of the medical community, you have a really special insight into how this virus is affecting the medical community in particular. What are you hearing from doctors who are on the front lines of this virus every single day and really being forced to look this virus straight in the face? What has that been like for your community?
Well, you and I both celebrate our first responders and the men and women that have been on the front lines and have fought this. From a personal perspective, I have seen my colleagues just roll up their sleeves, and they have been strong and faithful to what we've done for our whole careers. And it's just, I think the whole country has celebrated what people have done. And it's nothing short of a miracle, actually.
And as a advisory board member of Women for Trump, I want to just switch lanes a little bit here. Vice President Joe Biden, obviously he's running for president, and he is talking. He's been accused of essentially sexual assault, and a lot of members of the media have been hesitant to cover this. They haven't been doing it as well as they should. What do you think about the Tara Reade accusation?
Well, hypocrisy is not attractive. And I find it challenging when we, during the Kavanaugh hearings, we had this believe all women mantra, and now we have a believe Joe Biden mantra. And I just believe in due process. I think everyone should be heard. And that just makes sense to me. It should be fair. It should be covered fairly. And I just find the hypocrisy of the Joe Biden situation very worrisome.
Mm-hmm. And last question here, what have you personally been doing? Obviously, the entire country is in lockdown. Millions and millions of people are stuck at home. What have you been doing to stay sane?
Well, I think we all had whiplash for a week or two. And then after adaptation set in, I have a almost 4-year-old son. And my husband and I have just decided we're going to enjoy the time with him. I've enjoyed watching him interact with his school friends online. And we've just tried to look back. Hopefully we can look back and realize these were some special moments. So I've been going to my office. I've been baking a lot of cookies and spending a lot of time with my sweet boy.